19 the mental development and the purity and arahanthood or nirvana. But he could not answer. The learned monks could not answer. Then he asked the same question from the other monks who have not learned the Dhamma but attained higher stage of sainthood and experienced the Nibbanic bliss. So he could answer all the questions. After that, the Buddha had to utter these words. So the knowledge is not the most important thing. Practice, realization and experience. Vast knowledge sometimes creates more confusion. If the person is not attained the highest stage of sainthood. Now we learn various religions, different philosophies and other worldly subjects, science, psychology. But the more we learn, the more we create confusion in our mind. It is very difficult for us to come to any conclusion whenever there is any issues because of that vast knowledge. But those who have not learned even languages, those who cannot read or write, but their way of thinking, sharp thinking power in their mind and understanding, deep understanding, can give better idea than those who are learned. This is the difference between understanding, realization and experience. And the other side, by maintaining knowledge, theories, belief and memories. Now let us see what the Buddha has said. Bahum piche sahitam bhasamano gatakkaro hoti narupamatto. One who can recite or one who can remember all the sutras or the teachings of the Buddha but does not try to put into action, to practice. Without practicing, he increased his knowledge, his memory. That person is just like a man who look after somebody else's house. These are the parables that they give in those days. But he doesn't experience, he doesn't gain more profit. Just only a small salary. But the owner experience all the good result. Milk and curd and ghee and butter and everything he experienced. But the man who look after house get a small salary for his survival. So, one who has vast knowledge is just like that man who look after the house. Again he says, appam piche sahitam bhasamano dhammasya hoti anudhammacha. Although the knowledge is very little, memory is very poor, but by realizing dhamma and anudhamma are these two words, by realizing dhamma and anudhamma. What is dhamma here? And what is anudhamma? Here, sotapanna, sakadagami, anagami, arahanta, four mangas. Sotapanna, sakadagami, anagami, arahanta, four phala. Nirvana. Nine. Nava lokottara dhamma. This is the real dhamma. Nava means nine. Lokottara means supramande, highest. Not dealing with worldly things or worldly conditions, but above the worldly condition. Navalokottara. Then what are these four? Sotapanna, Satadagami, Anagami, Arahanta, Magga means path. First, get into the path. Immediately after getting into this path, that person experiences the good result. That we call phala. It is like this. Now you want to cross a river. Then you get into a boat and sit down. That is like get into the magga. You enter into the magga, the path. After crossing the river, you have landed the other side of the bank. Then phala, you experience. You gain what you wanted. This is the difference between magga and phala. And I have explained how we can experience or gain these four magga and four phalas. There are 10 fetters, 10 kinds of defilements or bondages which hinder our spiritual journey, spiritual development. So we have to cut off them one by one, not at once, because they were deeply rooted in our mind and we are bound to this world because of these 10 kinds of fetters. And all our problems and worries and disturbances that we experience because of these bondages. To attain the first stage of sainthood, sotapanna. Sota means a stream. Apanna means get into the stream. The water runs only in this way. Not upward. So person who get into this stream, follow the stream, the water current, without going upward. That means, the person who still remain in sansara, in this worldly life, step by step, slowly, reaching towards nirvana, never come back to the worldly life. The water just flow only this way. So in the same manner, one who attains sotapanna can guarantee that this person never becomes an animal after his or her death. Before that, there is no guarantee. That this person never becomes a devil or ghost or spirit after attaining sotapanna. This person never becomes either mentally retarded or mad person. And this person never go to hell. But before we reach this stage, there is no guarantee because changes can take place in the mind. At any time. Now you have very strong belief, faith, devotion, confidence, but all these are very uncertain, changing. Circumstances, temptation, or irritation can change your mind. That means you maintain these good qualities without removing the main root of the evil thoughts from your mind. They remain. So when disturbances take place or when external objects influence the mind, those hidden evil roots influence the mind. Then you have no controlling power. At that time you can do any nasty or any wicked, any immoral thing. You lose your sense of reasoning also because of that. And this is the uncertainty. So what are these three that we have to eradicate completely in order to attain the first stage of sainthood? Sakkāya diṭṭhi, vicikicchā, sīlabbata, parāmāsa. The belief that people maintain there is an eternal soul, Atma, either created by God or that come into existence automatically. And this eternal soul will be landed or reached either in heaven or Brahma world or somewhere else and remains forever as eternal or everlasting life. That belief is an hindrance for our spiritual development, because there is no reality. It is only imagination that develops craving, attachment, inclination towards something. So Buddha has rejected this belief and introduced as an hindrance for the spiritual development. Vicikicchā, a skeptical doubt. A skeptical doubt means without analyzing, without studying, without thinking, without reasoning, people reject certain things. At once, they say, oh, we don't believe. Very difficult to believe. Very difficult to accept. But they never take the trouble to study and to investigate, to observe the truth. Those who maintain such skeptical ideas also never get the chance to develop the spiritual way of life. So we have to get rid of that. Sīlabbata parāmā. Sīlabbata parāmā. Attachment towards external rites and rituals, thinking simply by performing rites and rituals that they can find out their salvation. Still there are many in this world who believe by animal sacrifice, burning certain things and performing some rites and rituals, they can wash away all the bad luck and bad karma and sins committed by them and purify. So that belief, that attachment towards such belief is another hindrance. So Buddhism does not encourage people to perform various kinds of rites and rituals which are meaningless, no religious significance. But don't mix up rites and rituals for those religious services such as religious puja that we conduct in the temple, such as offerings of flowers, light, incense, and worshipping and paying homage and reciting certain sutras. They are not under rites and rituals. They are the external expression of the devotion and understanding. Without doing anything, without performing anything, if we are trying to practice a religion, that religion won't last long. We have to do something. We have to organize something. Then others also come and join and participate, although they cannot understand at the beginning. Through these practices, they get into religious way of life. Especially young people, children, they like these kind of practices. Later, when they realize the Dhamma, they pay more attention toward knowledge and understanding and religious way of life. Therefore, traditional, cultural, religious practices are important to maintain religious way of life. Simply by talking or talking about philosophy or psychology or morals or ethics, it is difficult to maintain a religion. So there are a lot of cultural and traditional activities that we had introduced to influence the normal mind to get into religious way of life. So they are not under rites and rituals. So when we give up these three, that belief in eternal soul and skeptical doubt, and we develop our understanding and confidence by knowing, then we do not depend on external rites and rituals for our salvation. Then the mind will be free from these three. Then only get the chance to attain the first stage of faith. Knowledge cannot bring a man into a thing. Next one, Satadaga. There are two things that we had to reduce. We cannot eradicate completely because they are so strong in our mind, it is impossible for us to uproot at once. To attain the second stage of sainthood, we had to remove, say, 50%. What are those two? Craving for sensual pleasure and hatred. Very strong in our mind. Craving for sensual pleasure, this is the kama loka, sensual world. Living beings, humans and animals and devas are crazy for pleasure, indulgence. But to attain sainthood, we had to get it up. So the second stage can be reached only reducing these two. Hatred, it is not anger. Anger is emotion. Anger can be used for various good purposes. By expressing emotional feelings without creating hatred or ill will in the mind. Now parents show their anger towards the children, but they have no hatred in their mind. They shout, they beat, they threaten. By showing their anger for good purpose, to train them, to educate them, for them to be good. The intention is good, but they show their anger. It is not, hatred is not anger. This is, there is something inside the mind, keep as ill will, always waiting to see some sort of disruption. Now that is called hatred or ill will. So this one also very, very deep in our mind, so we have to reduce at least 50%. And then attain the second stage. That is called Satadagami. Sakrat Agami, once return. That means, if not attain arahanthood within that lifetime, rebirth can take place only once. After attaining the first stage of Sotapanna, rebirth can take place 7 times. No 8th birth for that person. That means not enough petrol to run the motor car. Craving, going on, reducing, life after life cannot run the machine. But within this period, that person never become animals or never go to hell, never become unfortunately with me. That guarantee is there. Then, third one, anagami. Anagami never returns. If not attained arahanthood, what will happen? After his or her death, rebirth or existence take place in one of the Suddhavasa Brahma worlds, pure abode. In Mahayana Buddhism, a school, they introduced this as pure land. They expanded and what you call exaggerated, beautified, decorated, wonderful. Introduced as pure land. But originally, it is Kosuddha Avas, pure abode, where these anagamis remain until they attain arahanthood there in that particular area. They never come back to a worldly life. That is why it is called na-agami, never return to this worldly life. After that, attain nirvana from there. To attain this third stage, sensual pleasure and hatred that we have reduced 50%, and the other 50% we had to completely eradicate. Otherwise, no third stage of sainthood. Then the last one, arahantam. Arahantam means worthy. Worthy one. Worthy for respect, worthy for homage, worthy for offering, worthy for anything. To attain this five more bondages. Because we carry these bondages up to the last stage. See how deep they are in our mind. They are craving for fine material world, rupa loka, craving for immaterial world, arupa loka, then mana, pride, conceit, uddhaccha, restlessness in the mind, avijja, ignorance. Ignorance we carry up to the last stage. Craving for fine material world. People believe that life in Brahma world is higher, more superior than human and deva. And there they can spend thousands and thousands of years and very refined, very soothing, very peaceful, very contented life. So people like it. But they never think that this is also impermanent. That is not everlasting. Many people, even before and after the Buddha, maintain this belief. In Brahma world, they can find everlasting life. The Buddha rejected that belief. It is not everlasting. Then the second one is arupa. The life without physical body. We cannot believe because we cannot understand. According to the Buddha, it is an utter waste. They can spend their millions of years. But one day, there will be an end to this life. So the Buddha did not encourage for people to develop their meditation for this attainment, and he had to give up this belief. But attainment of arupa, loka, is an illusion. He had to get rid of this belief. Third one is mana. Mind is Christ. We have three kinds of mind. We are higher than the others. As a race, or our culture, our tradition, our language, our religion are higher than the others. That is Christ. Second stage, we are not low, we are not below. We are equal. So they maintain our race, our religion, our tradition, our culture, our way of life, also equal to others, not below. So we maintain that also because of that fact. Although there is no reality. Third one, it's called Hinaman, inferiority complex. When people suffer from this, they show very funny face, inferiority complex. Some sort of pride is there in the mind. It is the negative side. So therefore, they are not normal at that time. Something is wrong somewhere. When they suffer from inferiority complex. These three kinds of mind, this is also under this. See how a strong disc in our mind, we never drop it until we attain the highest stage of sainthood. So, the sources that we use, our race, our color, their proud, and our language, our religion, our culture. Then we try to justify. We are higher than others. And all these troubles and problems and discriminations and hostilities and calamities take place in this world because of that. So it is very difficult to think that we should not show any discrimination. We should not hostile towards others. Very difficult. So we maintain this. But by keeping that in our mind, we cannot attain nirvana. Not allowed. Not ever. We have to talk to it. Then, Buddhatya. This is another big problem. Restlessness in our mind. And we do not know where this restlessness comes from. We experience some sort of uneasiness, unhappiness. Something is wrong somewhere, but we do not know. And this is the nature of our mind. There are two reasons for that. Certain bad things that we have committed earlier, guilty concern, that feeling creates some sort of disturbance in the mind. That I have committed this, I have done this, I have done this. Another thing, certain concepts that they have been keeping in their mind for a long period, which was submerged. When the mind is not very steady, when the other beliefs and concepts are not very strong, those hidden concepts again influence the mind. Subconscious mind. Are these concepts disturb the mind? So we have to cleanse the mind by uprooting all the existing defilements from the mind. Otherwise, there is no arahanthood or salvation or nirvana. That restlessness disturbs the mind. Last one is avidya. Avidya means avidya. Difficult to see the things properly, the meaning of the word. The difficulty that we experience to see the things properly. We always get the wrong identity. Our definition, our recognition, our analysis, our interpretation are only superficial. Only outlook. But we do not know how to analyze and open and see what it is. And that is foolishness. It is true. All of us, our educators, we are. But ignorance is very deep. We come to certain conclusions, definitions, by using that limited mind or knowledge or senses, but later we will come to know that our definition is wrong because of that avidya, that ignorance. When the realization in true proper perspective appeared in the mind, there is no place for that ignorance. There are four ways or four methods for us to get rid of these wrong concepts, wrong beliefs, wrong ideas, and mental defilement. The first stage is called Pahana. Pahana means cleanse the mind from these birds. Tadanga Pahana. For the time being, we purify our mind through our knowledge and understanding. By knowing that this is good, this is bad, this is useful, this is dangerous. But this realization won't last long. Because that the purity we had at that moment, again, will be clouded, deluded by various other defilements. We take an example. You want to clean your garden. When you see there are a lot of lala. So you cut completely by using a moon or any other instrument. Now the garden is completely clean. No more garden. No more lala. Clean. But after a few weeks, you can see how it will come up. Because the roots are there. As long as the roots remain there, you cannot stop growing this way. So by realizing certain things, by understanding certain things, these things are wrong, therefore we don't know to do. These things are good, therefore we must do. But this decision won't last long. Circumstances change the mind, influence the mind, again start to grow. Because the roots of the evil thoughts are there, just like lalang roots. Unless, until you remove these things completely from the mind, you cannot maintain purity for a long period, only for a short time. Again, the dark clouds come and occupy the mind. That is called Tadanga Pahana. Next one is Vikshandana Pahana. Through meditation, people attain dhyana stage.
కఠిన అధ్యాన బుద్ధి అధ్యాన సత్య అధ్యాన చతుష్ట అధ్యాన
when they attain this dhyana by suppressing their evil thoughts or mental defilement, they gain very energetic, very powerful mental energy to maintain purity, to lead pure religious life. But can maintain for a certain period. Through dhyana, a person cannot eradicate all the defilement from the mind. Again, since this person has not eradicated the roots of the evil, craving, hatred and illusion from the mind, slowly, 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 these things again start to grow. After growing and growing and growing, then become the defilement, then they occupy the mind. Then develop craving, attachment, and hatred, and illusion. Many those who have attained this dhyanic state, who could perform certain supernatural or miraculous power by using this dhyana state, their mental energy, they have completely dropped to the ground, to the bottom again, because they wanted to abuse, misuse their dhyana power for their material gain, worldly power for their pleasure. But after gaining this dhyana stages through meditation, they can maintain purity in their mind for a certain period. The third one is samuccheda-pahana. Samuccheda-pahana means attainment of sotāgāmi, sakadāgāmi, anāgāmi, arahanta, jhanna, etc. By eradicating 10 fetters, those who have attained that higher state maintain complete purity, samuccheda-pahana, completely purified mind. Now, in that mind, craving never appears, anger never appears, ignorance never appears, because the mind is pure. They cannot create any bad karma or any karma. No craving to create any karma. Next one is more important. Patittasamya. Some people cannot understand. This is the difference between the Buddha and Arahant. The Buddha is the only person who is free from this weakness. But Arahant is also not free. What is called samsaric habit. The habit that we maintain life after life, good and bad both. When he talked to others, he used a very funny language to address people without using polite word or respectable word, just like talking to laborers or coolies. No respectable word when he talked to others. So many people and the other monks came and reported to the Buddha, why this monk talked in this very insulting way? Then the Buddha wanted to find out the reason. He knew that this man was in Brahmin caste, during so many previous births. Brahmins have very strong belief that they are higher than all the others in this world. When they talk to others, they never respect others, because they think all the others are low. They also mention in their holy book, God created Brahmas from his mouth. They came out from the God's mouth. So they are the ones who perform all religious duties and rites and ceremonies. They are the teachers, masters, and for everything. So they do not respect others, thinking that they are higher. And because of this samsaric habit, this monk, although he is an arahant, is still using the same language. Therefore, we cannot blame him. So this kind of weakness or good habits, every person, everybody in this world maintain their own habits, not introduced by their parents or by relatives or friends, their own. So when you observe children from their childhood, we can study this very carefully, what they like, what they do not like. That is their intrinsic character. And this is called samsaric habit. Their talents and weaknesses, intelligence, all these things come as samsaric habit. Now we are going on developing these habits life after life. Now you pay more attention to a religious way of life. This will become your habit. But there are many more in this town, in this country, in this world, who do not pay attention towards religious way of life. Their way of thinking is entirely different. So your way of thinking becomes your habit. So in the next life, very easily you can get into religious way of life because of this habit. Those who are used to perform or to use music or dance or cultural practices or science or technology or languages, philosophy, there are so many evidences to prove from their childhood, even before they study ABCD, how they have shown their talents because of this samsaric habit. So, weaknesses that we perform, although we have completely purified the mind. An example is given. When we switch off this fan, this won't, this cannot stop, doesn't stop at once. It's moving slowly, 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 take at least 1 minute or 2 minutes to stop this fan completely. When we collect some charcoal or firewood for cooking or boiling water here on the ground, after that we completely clean the plate. But when you touch, you can see it's still very warm. Our samsaric habits are like this. Although the mental defilements are removed from the mind, still habits remain. So the Buddha is the only person who is free from this. Even arahants also, but they don't commit any bad things or any bad karma, certain things which are regarded as mistake, then now you can understand how difficult it is for us to maintain complete purity in our mind. The reason is, our minds are actually just like dustbin, collected rubbish life after life. We are going on collecting more rubbish than good things. Very seldom we collect good things. We do certain things, we say certain things, we think certain ideas, either to create our craving, or our anger, or our jealousy, or ill will, or ignorance. Very seldom we do something to develop the mind, but to add more and more rubbish into the mind. So we are going on collecting, collecting, accumulating, accumulating so many layers. So the difficulty that we are experiencing within this lifetime is how to remove, how to cleanse the mind completely. Not so easy. Some people come and say, oh, this modern Buddhism, it's a shortcut to Nirvana. Within this lifetime, we can send you to Nirvana. They try to introduce in this way. But you, when you use your common sense, you can understand. To get rid of one weakness from your mind, one lifetime also not enough. Can you get rid of your jealousy? Although you work throughout your life, what about the rest? They talk rubbish, you know, to mislead people. We can send you to Nirvana within this lifetime. Here the way how the Buddha tried to introduce. Why the Buddha had to work such a long period to purify his mind, to gain his wisdom and enlightenment, if it is so easy? You think, the Buddha's mind is not computerized. It is a gradual development. You cannot put the discard at one and press this button, now there, the Nirvana is there now. There is no that type of Buddhism. Now the meaning I have explained. The knowledge that we accumulate by learning does not serve the purpose. Although the knowledge is very poor, if we use our effort to purify the mind, then we experience better results. I have mentioned an item in my book, What Buddhists Believe. A French scholar has written a book. The title is Learned Ignorance. He explained in his book, the more we learn, the more we enlarge our ignorance. He is correct. That is what the Buddha says here. You can see, you know Buddhism, Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, Judaism, and all the existing religions. You know philosophy, psychology, modern science and biology, chemistry, geography, everything. You know language, Chinese, English and Latin and Greek and everything. But still you are stupid. All these things you have accumulated in your mind, collected, but your jealousy, your anger, your greed, all these things are still boiling inside you. That is why he says, the more you learn, more you enlarge your craving, the more you enlarge your pride, the more you enlarge your ignorance, because you create imagination. That is what the Buddha said. You can learn whole Tripitaka, 45 years teachings of the Buddha, you can utter every word of the Buddha, but never practice. Useless. No meaning at all. Even without learning, by using your common sense and understanding, realizing this is right, this is wrong, that is enough. Don't go beyond that. If you practice this, you can see the better result than developing your knowledge and memory. So the practice is more important than knowledge. But in another place, Pariyatti, Patipatti, Patived, three aspects. Pariyatti, knowledge. Without knowledge, when you are going to practice, you make mistake. Therefore, knowledge is important to practice correctly, without making mistake. After practicing Patived, realization, you realize and experience. So only three things we have to do. First, we have to study. After studying, we practice. After practicing, we realize and experience. So knowledge also important, but knowledge itself doesn't serve any purpose if there is no practice.